Welcome to Public Health On Call, a podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. I'm Joshua Sharfstein, Vice Dean for Public Health Practice and Community Engagement and a former health commissioner here in Baltimore. Our goal is to bring evidence and experience to illuminate critical public health issues. If you have questions or ideas for us, please send an email to publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes.
Hi, I'm Lindsay Smith-Rogers, producer of Public Health On Call. Today, Stephanie Desmon talks to Dr. John Aucott, a Lyme disease expert at Johns Hopkins, about how to protect yourself from the tick-borne illness, how 10 to 20% of those who come down with Lyme experience persistent symptoms long beyond the normal course of disease, and how the similarity to those who experience long COVID could lead to new treatments for both. Let's listen. John Aucott, thanks so much for joining me.
Great to be here.
So today we're going to talk about Lyme disease, and I want to start easy. So I know that Lyme was first diagnosed almost 50 years ago. What is it?
So Lyme disease is an infectious disease. It's caused by a bacteria, but the unique thing is the way the bacteria gets into the human body is through the bite of a tick. So it's what's called a vector-borne or tick-borne infectious disease.
And I guess people want to know sort of how to avoid it.
Yeah. So the way to avoid it is to avoid getting bitten by ticks. And this is the time of the year. These nymph stage small ticks are the size of a poppy seed. They're really small, and they come out routinely in May, June, July, and August every year, because that's when these nymph stage ticks come out. Of course, that's when we go out and enjoy our gardens and our hikes and all our outdoor activities. So the way to avoid it is to do those things carefully with precautions. So wearing the right clothing, long pants, consider treating your pants with permethrin, which is a compound that kills ticks in your clothing, doing tick checks when you come in from the outdoors, and then recognizing what the telltale skin lesion looks like if you're unfortunate enough to get a tick bite that you don't notice. Recognizing the rash is the last step of avoiding, you know, the problems of Lyme disease. So it's preventing tick bites and then recognizing the rash of early Lyme disease.
So Lyme disease has spread across the country, has it not? It started in the Northeast. Why is it? Tell us the scope of the issue and why is this happening?
So it was first recognized actually in three locales in the late 70s, the Northeast, U.S., Upper Midwest and Minnesota, and then the Pacific Northwest. And these were areas where the ticks had always been in North America, but the niche had been reduced dramatically through agriculture in the 1800s and early 1900s. It eliminated the habitat for the ticks and the deer that the ticks feed on and the mice that harbor the bacteria. And so the niche ecologically was gone because we'd clear cut all the forests in North America. But in the middle 1900s, those forests started to come back. The mouse populations expanded, the deer populations exploded. And with that, the ticks then started to explode as well. So it's what's called a geographically expanding disease, because those niches in the East, Upper Midwest, and West, then geographically, as the ecologic niches expanded, the disease expanded. So now Maryland, instead of being a clear-cut state of agriculture, you know, people live on houses on 5-acre lots that support deer, ticks, and mice. The ecologic niche is perfect now, where it wasn't 100 years ago. And so as that's happened, the deer and birds have spread the infected ticks into those new niches. Actually, we've spread it up into Canada now, across the Great Lakes, all the way down the East Coast into Virginia, westward to the westward border of Pennsylvania. So it's a geographically expanding, actually every year it just expands as the ticks are moved on the backs of deer and mice and birds into new areas that support the ecologic niche now in the new environment.
Does climate change have anything to do with that?
Possibly, especially going north. Warmer climates tend to allow the mouse populations to expand. The mouse actually harbors the bacteria. That's the bacteria that causes Lyme disease is called Borrelia burgdorferi. It lives in mice. And so the mice populations probably have expanded into Canada more as it's warmed up. Going south, the warming doesn't really help the expansion. It's more going north.
Interesting. So talk to me about, like, how common is Lyme disease and how easy is it to treat?
So it's very common. You know, if you, it's estimated that there's about 500,000 new cases a year now in the United States. It's incredibly common because the ticks are incredibly common now. And so, you know, if you live in a Lyme endemic area, which is really anywhere where you see deer, you know, you have to be careful now. It's easiest to treat when you identify the earliest stage, which is when you have that rash. What the problem is, most people are looking for that telltale stereotypical bullseye rash that you see like the side of a Target department store. Actually, most of them don't look like that. And so the mistake we see over and over again is people get a round red skin lesion, but it doesn't have that ring within a ring. And so they say, oh, it's not Lyme disease, didn't have the Target lesion. Actually, most of them don't have that classic Target lesion. So if you catch it early with that skin lesion, it's pretty easy to treat. If you miss the skin lesion, or it's in a place you can't see it, or some people may not even have it, or it's not where you can see it, then it gets harder to treat because the bacteria spreads from the skin through the bloodstream to other areas of your body, the heart, the nervous system, the joints. And that's when you get the later manifestations, which can be more severe, meningitis, heart disease, arthritis. And those are the tougher ones to treat. Those come on months or even sometimes years after the tick bite, if you miss the opportunity to treat it at that first stage.
So there's a group of people who have long-term symptoms after Lyme. Could you talk about them a little?
Right. So there's a group of people that are eventually diagnosed and get treated with antibiotics. The treatment's antibiotics because it's an infectious disease. They get their antibiotics, but they don't seem to recover. This is kind of analogous to long-haul COVID, right? The acute COVID virus infection's gone, but there's those long-hauler patients that months later are still ill. Same thing happens with Lyme disease. The subset of people that get diagnosed get the right antibiotic, but for some reason don't return to their prior health. And it's about the same percentage. It's somewhere around 10 to 20% of people after these infections like COVID or Lyme disease, 10 to 20% just don't seem to regain their prior normal health. And in Lyme disease, the patients call that chronic Lyme disease. In the research world, we call it post-treatment Lyme disease. It's actually, some people are calling it long-haul Lyme in the analogy to long-haul COVID.
So there was a time when people, when the medical community wasn't convinced this was actually a thing. Could you talk me through that?
It's been hard to prove because no one had ever really done the right study. To really prove it, the right study is to get patients with well-documented Lyme disease at the beginning, treat them with the standard of care antibiotics, and then follow to see over time how many people return to health and how many people don't. And then the tricky part is to have controls to compare to, right? Because the symptoms like fatigue and achiness are also present in the general population. So unless you have controls, you don't know whether the symptoms of long-haul Lyme are just a coincidence and they're just what's in the general population. So we actually did that study over the last 10 years. We identified people with early Lyme disease, treated them, followed them after treatment for 6 months, and compared their symptoms to control patients without Lyme disease. It turns out the number is actually 14% of the people develop these long-haul symptoms. So we think this study, which was just recently published 2 months ago in the peer-reviewed literature, really once and for all should put the controversy to rest. In a well-controlled prospective study, post-treatment Lyme disease or long-haul Lyme occurs in 14% of the people. Simultaneously, another group did a study in New York, another respected researcher, and they got 20%. So we're in the right ballpark, 10 to 20%. Coincidentally, that's about what's seen in long-haul COVID too. And also what's seen after chronic EBV infection, Epstein-Barr, it's about the same number that develop chronic fatigue syndrome. So there's something about certain infections that trigger a response of persistent symptoms in a subset of vulnerable people. And that subset's around 10 to 20%.
Mm-hmm. It's been this controversy, I understand, has been hard on patients, right? Because their doctors, these are vague symptoms, right? And sometimes their doctors don't believe them. And sometimes it's very hard to get the correct diagnosis.
That's right. And the reason it is because there's no blood test for any of these illnesses. doctors like to confirm patients' symptoms with blood tests. And there's no blood test that confirms long haul COVID. There's no blood test that confirms long haul Lyme, chronic Lyme. And there's no blood test that confirms chronic fatigue syndrome. The diagnoses are all based on the constellation of symptoms in the context of having been triggered by one of those infections, but there's no blood test. And so that's why they're still kind of contested illnesses. Because if you go as a patient, go to your doctor and say, I'm tired. Of course, there's 100 reasons you might be tired. And unless your doctor is astute enough to realize that may have been triggered by the COVID you had 6 months ago or the Lyme disease you had a year ago, they won't put two and two together because the triggering infection often occurred months or even years before they're seeing the doctor with the fatigue and achiness and brain fog. And, you know, the interesting thing is those three symptom complexes, brain fog, you know, trouble thinking, fatigue and pain are common to all these illnesses. That's what you see in long haul COVID. It's what you see in chronic Lyme. It's what you see in chronic fatigue. It's something, again, the human response to these infections that generate these long-term symptoms, it seems to be stereotypical, causing fatigue, the trouble focusing and concentrating, and the pain. So there's a common pathway we theorize. And so we're actually encouraged by the attention that long haul COVID has brought to these illnesses, because we think that this is an opportunity, again, to refocus research on the why question. Why does this happen? We think we've proven that it does happen, but we still got to figure out why, because that's what we need to figure out, the effect of treatments. Because until we know the why, we don't know the best treatment for any of these illnesses.
I was going to ask you about that, because it seems as though the long haul COVID was quickly accepted that this was a thing and that people were really suffering from this. And I know that long-term Lyme disease has been very controversial, right? So it took forever for people to get, perhaps people get paid attention to, right? So is that heartening to people? Are they frustrated? Are they angry?
All of the above. So I think, you know, the problem with Lyme disease is it's an insidious epidemic. You know, it's been perking along for decades, slowly expanding, really affecting hundreds of thousands of people, but it's been very insidious, right? COVID was a bomb, right? It was a bomb epidemic. And so I think that's why it got so much attention. You know, the numbers in Lyme disease are, you know, hundreds of thousands. The numbers in COVID, of course, are millions. So I think it got more attention. I think most of the patients with chronic fatigue and chronic Lyme are encouraged by the attention that's being paid. We laid the groundwork, you know, by showing that these other infections can trigger these illnesses. And so it was easier for the long haul COVID patients to get some acceptance. Although I will say they often also can face, you know, barriers, because again, when you have symptoms that are what doctors call vague or non-specific, like fatigue. Even with COVID, I think some of the patients have been a hard time getting recognized. And again, it's frustrating because we don't know the why, so we don't know the actual best treatment at this point. And that makes it difficult for patients and doctors alike to grapple with it. But I think the numbers are overwhelming with COVID, so we can't ignore it. You know, the numbers here are going to be, you know, they're going to impact the healthcare system dramatically. You know, already there's clinics popping up all over the place for long haul COVID, where for chronic Lyme and persistent symptoms with Lyme, there's still not a lot of clinics specializing in that because it hasn't been, so it doesn't get the media attention, you know, that, you know, the epidemic of COVID's gotten.
Mm-hmm. Do you think that because of this confluence, we're going to be closer to getting to the why?
I do. I think because a lot of money is being poured into the COVID research, and I think there'll be crosstalk because, again, I think it's likely many of the mechanisms are similar. So we're hoping that there'll be cross collaboration between the disciplines and that the huge influx of money for COVID research will help us indirectly understand the why for persistent Lyme symptoms and chronic fatigue symptoms.
John Aucott, thanks so much for joining me.
My pleasure.
Public Health on Call is produced by Joshua Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, and Stephanie Desmon. Audio production by J.B. Arbogast, Holly Cardinal, Spencer Greer, and Matthew Martin, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Production support from Catherine Ricardo. Social media run by Grace Holes Fernandez and Amber Bryan Singletary. Thank you for listening.